I will not so much discuss about resonances now. I will more concentrate on how to produce and propagate uncertainties related to measurement results. So I'm Peter Schillebeeks, and I got my PhD at the Ghent University, like Jan did, but on fission fragment properties and neutron-induced fission cross-sections. Then I went to the ILL, where I did more nuclear structure measurements using the GAMS spectrometers, where I was local contact for the crystal spectrometers. Then I moved to a complete other field in ISPRA, at the GRC in ISPRA, where I helped on the development of non-destructive techniques for nuclear safeguards and nuclear security applications. And then I came back to the GRC and IRMM in Geel. And now, since 2001, I'm producing, we try to produce neutron-induced reaction cross-section data. And this is still open, and that's probably within 6 years and a half. So. this is an overview of what I will discuss. So I will go through the basic law of uncertainty propagation and how to produce and propagate correlated uncertainties and covariances. And I will try to show you that these are there are no secrets behind, and correlations, you can fill them in yourself. You don't have to guess them. It is straightforward. Once you understand your measurement process, you can easily produce covariances, and you can easily propagate them. Then I will discuss a bit about least squares fitting and some problems related to least squares fitting, but they are all related to reliable covariances. And then a few comments on the use of definitions and terminology. So first, of course, when we produce a measurement result, it's only valuable if you also give its uncertainty. So what we need to do is to start with uncertainty propagation to get a proper measurement result. And I give a scheme here. So, and this scheme illustrates how we try to measure, for example, the alpha activity of a sample. So what we do is we have a sample which emits alpha radiation, and we have a detector here. So what we have is what we measure. The measured quantity is the count rate in the detector. And what we want to determine is the alpha activity of the sample. Now, first of all, in the detector, we will have we will not only detect the counts which come from the sample here, but there will also be a background component. So the background component has to be controlled. Secondly, the count rate, the net count rate here, is related to the alpha activity, but there are other factors involved. First of all, the alphas have to escape from the sample, so we have an escape probability to take into account an escape probability from the sample. We have the solid angle between the sample and the diafragments which we put and the detector. So that solid angle depends on this distance and on these apertures from these diafragmas. And then we have also to take into account the detection efficiency of our detector, which detects the alphas. So this goes a bit fast. So this is, in this case, what I call the model. So this model links the quantity that we measure with the quantity that we want to determine. And you see that there is some difficult relations between. Here the relation is quite simple, but sometimes this relation can be very complicated. Godverdomme. So again, the same thing here. Now what we can also have is, for example, if we count if we do a count rate as function of time, then we can try to determine the decay constant, which is related to the alpha decay in the sample. And then to do this, we do a least squares fitting. And so I will try to explain how we can properly propagate uncertainties which are related to these two analysis procedures. So summarizing, so we have a lot of input quantities. We have a model, and this model leads us, together with the input quantities, to the output quantity. So now the input quantities can be measurement results. We have the count rate in the alpha detector, but we can also, the background is mostly also part of a measurement result. Then we have, in the input quantities can be calibration constants, influencing quantities like temperature or pressure, And we can have physical constants like the velocity of light, or even, and in our case, in cross-section measurements, also nuclear data, which are related to nuclear data standards like the cross-section standards for neutron-induced reactions. So all this leads then to the quantity that we want to observe. Now, all these input quantities mostly have an uncertainty. So to these, that means that these input quantities, to the input quantities, we can also link a probability distribution. And so ideally, we propagate full probability distribution, which is related to each input quantity to get the output. Now, that is what, in an ideal case. What we mostly do, and what you are all used to do, is we apply what we call the general law of uncertainty propagation. And this general law of uncertainty propagation is, in principle, based on two concepts. That is, that we suppose that all the input quantities are normal distributed. And in case we have a nonlinear problem, that we first do a first Taylor development. So you see here, this is, now I give a simple scheme of operations that you are mostly used to. So we have a background correction, and we multiply with a factor. You are wondering, Ralph?
We can discuss this later.
But I think I will come to your so these are practically the most frequent operations that you will apply. Background correction and multiplication with the constant. So we have an experimental observable y with its uncertainty and the background with its uncertainty, and so we have to propagate this to the variable z. And the same when we do apply a correction factor on our observable, we have the measurement here, and then we apply a correction factor which also has an uncertainty. So now what you are used to is we can propagate these uncertainties, and you in this case you quadratically sum the uncertainties when y and b are independent. And the same thing here. Then you can multiply with your factor, and then you have a very simple equation where you practically quadratically sum the quadrat of the relative uncertainties. This is for independent variables. And this, you all know how to do that. So and these relations are practically based on the fact that we suppose that they are all normal distributed, the uncertainties. And why is that? So if z is a linear function of independent random variables, which are normally distributed, then the probability distribution of z is also a normal distribution. That we know from statistical theory. And then the mean of z is nothing else than this. If z is a linear combination of n independent random variables, this is the mean of z. It's a very simple function, and we also know how to make the variance of z, of the normal distribution of z. It's just given by this equation. So that is the equations that we normally use, and that's all based on this property of the normal distribution. Now, if we have a nonlinear function of independent random variables, we can apply the same formulas, because what we can do is we can Taylor develop the function in the region of the mean of when we are already close to the value that we want to determine. And then you just apply exactly the same equations. That is for a nonlinear function. So in principle, you just apply exactly the same formula. But you just, and you have to calculate the derivatives with respect to the input quantities which create an uncertainty. Now, why can we do this, and why this all works? That is practically due to the fact that we can suppose that everything is normal distributed. And why is that? Because so if you have counting statistics, we know, they follow Poisson distribution. But as soon as you have a large mean value already, it is a normal distribution. Secondly, the central limit theorem says that if you have a sum of a large number of input quantities which are distributed of independent input quantities with a rather equal distribution, if you combine them, you end up with a normal distribution. And last but not least, there is the principle of maximum entropy, which says that if you only know the mean and the standard deviation of a given quantity, then the optimal probability distribution is a normal distribution. So these three theorems say that we can suppose that everything is in first order normal distributed. So here I show, for example, if you have counting statistics, here I show a Poisson distribution with a mean of 10, and in green I plot the corresponding normal distribution. So we can almost suppose that it's normal distributed. We say that above 30 you can practically suppose that it is normal distributed. Then for the central limit theorem, I give here three different distributions, a Gaussian distribution, a triangular distribution, and a rectangular distribution. If you combine all these three, then you end up here with a blue line. And then in green, I plot the corresponding normal distribution. So this is the central limit theorem. So this says that the z value, which comes from x1, x2, and x3, we can suppose that it's normal distributed with these parameters. So that is why we all apply all these formulas. Now I will go through you, with you through an experiment. Let's suppose that we measure y1 and y2 with their uncertainties, and they are independent. So I count twice the activity of a sample, and that is y1 with its uncertainty and y2 with its uncertainty. And I have once determined the background which is related to my experiment. So I have b plus minus with its uncertainty. Now I want to calculate the optimum, the ideal value, or the value which is related to y minus b from this experimental input. So what I can do is, I can make the average of these two values here, and then afterwards I can subtract from this average the background. So what do I get? The uncertainty which is related to this average is very simple. It's this one. It's given by this equation. Then I go to this z value. I subtract from this average value the background. And then I get, it's also very simple how to combine the uncertainties of the background together with the uncertainty now on, of this mean y. So I get this as a total uncertainty on my z value. Okay? Now, let me do it in another way. I first calculate z1, which is y1 minus, oh, this should be b, sorry. That should, this one and this two should go away. So it's y1 minus b, and z2 is y2 minus b. Okay? And then I will calculate from these two values my average z. So then the uncertainty on z1 is this one, and the uncertainty on z2 is this one. Very simple. Now I calculate the uncertainty on this z value, supposing that they are independent. And then I get this value. But I suppose that they are independent, using the previous formulas which I showed. And then you get this as a global uncertainty. And you see that these two uncertainties from the two different ways of analyzing the data are completely different. And that is due to the fact that Z1 and Z2, I was wrong by supposing that they were independent. So this is all what is about the covariances. And now I will show you how simple it is to take this into account. You just have to understand your experiment. So basically, we go back to statistical analysis theory, and Z is a linear function of random variables. If they are independent, we have these equations. When they are dependent, we have to take into account the covariance. It's all statistical theory. It's all in textbooks. Now, this looks like this in matrix notation, which makes it a bit more simple to understand. So what we have here is the covariance matrix of my input quantities. And here I have the gradient matrix. So these are nothing else than partial derivatives of your model with respect to the input quantities. And I will do this now, again, for my simple example of y minus b. So I produce z1, z2 from the input from my input quantities, which are y1, y2, and b. I will first determine z1, z2, and then I will, in step two, I will calculate again the average c. So let me first now determine z1 and z2. So the only thing what I need to do is to understand the variables, the input quantities of my experiment. And in this case, they are all independent, so I can easily construct my covariance matrix. I just put them all, the uncertainties on the diagonal term, and all the correlations here are zero. Since that I know I understand my experiment. As soon as you understand your experiment, you can build this up. If you can go to your first step, you can mostly build it up such that all your correlations are zero. Then I just have to calculate the derivatives of my quantity z with respect to my input quantities. And that is z1 versus y1, z1 versus y2, z1 versus the background, and here z2 versus y1, z2, y2, and the partial derivative of z2 versus b, and that's this simple matrix. As simple as that. And then I have to do a matrix multiplication. I have to transform transpose of this matrix. Here in the middle I have my covariance matrix, and here I have this matrix again. Very simple matrix multiplication. And if I do... which one? So this one is 3 by 3. This is 3 by 2, and that this is 3 by 3. This is, in this case, it is... The C is 2 by 3, yeah, that's correct. And this one is 3 by 2. Because I ask for two additional output quantities. So the final covariance matrix here is 2 by 2. Okay? So, and that you see here. So this one is my 3 by 3 covariance matrix of my input quantities. This is it's often also called the design matrix or the sensitivity matrix. It's all related to the model. This is from the experiment, and this is related to the model. Now you just do a few matrix multiplications and you get your covariance matrix of Z1 and Z2. Now I go to step two, and I calculate from Z1 and Z2, I calculate the average Z. I again just apply the same formula. So now the sensitivity matrix is a partial derivative of Z versus Z1 and a partial derivative of Z versus Z2, which is twice 1/2. And I calculate my covariance matrix of, I calculate the covariance matrix, which is now in this case only one value. And now I compare this one with my first evaluation of the average Z, and I get exactly the same uncertainty. And that is all what it is about covariances. And nothing else, nothing more. There is no secret. You just have to understand your measurement. Now in this case, people report y1, y2, and b. That means they report fully all the experimental input. They practically report the full experiment. In this case, they already report z1 and z2, which is already some kind of data reduction of the experiment. So that means that if you report z1, z2, you have to give the full covariance matrix, since that covariance matrix contains some information of your experiment. So that is it. That is covariances. Now, that was with two variables. Now you can go to the mathematics, and it's all again based on the properties of normal distributions, and you can easily expand it to more than one quantity, and you can also expand it to nonlinear functions based on the Taylor development, and you get always the same equation. And here I give them now in matrix notation, which are easier to read. So you have here the linear approach and here the nonlinear approach based on the first Albert Taylor development. And so these are the uncertainty propagation equations which you just have to remember. And that is what is called the sandwich formula. And that's all what you need to know. So, and here I give you just an over. So if you have more than one input quantity, this is the covariance matrix if you have a background subtraction. If you have n values which are all have to be corrected with the same background, this is the covariance matrix. You can make the mathematics of this one. It's very straightforward. That is the Yarkov variance matrix. If you, and then if you calculate the average z from this result here, you get this as an uncertainty. And here now you see that if I increase the number of measurements on y, I reduce the uncertainty on z. But I will never reduce the uncertainty on z due to the background component. That is a common component to all my input quantities, to all the y's. And I can do exactly the same what I did for the background. I can do it for with multiplying. You can do the mathematics yourself, and this is the covariance matrix if you multiply with a constant. If you have an n number of input quantities and you all multiply them with the same constant, then you create a correlated uncertainty component. You have the uncorrelated components, which is the y1 here, y2, yn, and yn. But you have always a correlated component. Now, I can again calculate the z, the average z, very straightforward, and here you get the formulas for free. There is one property, I go back now to the covariance matrix, there is one property of a covariance matrix, or two, in fact, that is that it is symmetric, since the non-diagonal terms are symmetric, and a covariance matrix, if we want to use it, it has to be positive definite. And Jan will explain why it is so important to have a positive definite covariance matrix. Now, what you also heard people mention quite a lot is the correlation coefficient. And there I want to spend some time on the correlation coefficient. Now, you see the covariance matrix. The correlation coefficient also comes from statistical theory. It's all about statistical theory, statistical analysis. So the correlation matrix you get by dividing all values with these cross terms. U z1 here. That is the definition of this correlation matrix. Okay? So this one is divided by itself. So it is always 1. All the diagonal terms are always 1. And this one here, because on this side I have z1, and here I have the dimension z1, z2, so here I divide by z, the uncertainty on z1, multiplied by the uncertainty of z2, and this one is symmetric. And this is the correlation matrix. Now I will calculate for you, I calculated for you, the correlation matrix, which is related to this simple exercise. So we have here the covariance matrix when we do a background subtraction. And this is the correlation matrix. Now, the correlation coefficient between the two values of z is given by this equation. And now you often hear that the correlation is this. This is an expression which I don't like, because the correlation reflects your experiment. Suppose that I have an experiment where my uncorrelated component is very large, the correlation is practically zero. It's all about how the uncertainties are combined. And so they reflect the quality and the input quantities, and they reflect how the experiment has been done. And there is not something like a fixed correlation coefficient. In this, no, in this, when you do background subtraction, never. Okay. Never. Multiplying with a constant, never. You just have to understand that it comes from your experiment. And this here, so my model is the background subtraction here, and then it comes from the model. But, and I will come back to that one also later on. So, I will do a quarter of an hour and then. So now we come to models, Ralph. So one of the models that we have is, for example, the analytical expression of our background due to our black resonances. So we have here, what we do is we fit an analytical curve through these points. So how do we do this? We mostly use chi-square minimization, okay? So, and then with chi-square, so we also have to do this when we fit for resonances. Then the model is a bit more complicated than our previous model. In the previous model, I only have exponentials, Now the model, I cannot write it down on this transparency here. So, but chi-square minimalization, in principle, you only have two equations. This is the parameter that you get out of the chi-square minimization, your optimal parameter, and this is the corresponding covariance matrix. If you have an experiment y, where you have y n values on y, and you have the covariance matrix on these points. So here I give you a very simple example. I have 3 points, and you can fit a straight line through it. So then the parameters of the straight line come from these two equations here. So to solve these two equations is also straightforward. So you just have to calculate the gradient, which is a sensitivity matrix with respect to your model. And you need to have the input from your experiment, your covariance matrix from your experiment. Now, in this case, I just suppose that they are diagonal, but you can easily get also covariance terms here, but I just, for representation purposes, I put them to zero here. But you can easily put in covariance terms here also. Then the model in this case, the gradient with respect to the model, is also very simple. So the partial derivative of the model with respect to parameter A0 is 1, and the partial derivative of with respect to A1 is x1, x2, and x3. And then you just have to plug these two matrices into these two equations, and you get the result. You get your parameters together with their covariances. So in this slide, I show you some people sometimes say maximum likelihood chi-square minimization. In principle, it's the same business. As soon as you suppose that your input quantities are normal distributed, they are exactly the same. Since if you maximize the likelihood of your parameter here, if you maximize it, you minimize this expression, which is nothing else than a chi-square minimization. So maximum likelihood and least squares is in principle the same thing if your input quantities are normal distributed. So, and therefore, because if you only take the diagonal terms, you suppose that the covariance terms are zero here in your covariance matrix, you practically minimize this expression, which is a sum of quadratic terms, and therefore it's called least squares adjustment. Okay? Now, here is again the mathematics behind a least squares adjustment. So we have a linear model where we have the partial derivatives of the function with respect to the parameters that we want to adjust. And then you get these equations for the parameter and for the covariance of the parameter. Now, you see that this term here is nothing else than the covariance of the parameters, and it's in this equation here. So if you program your business, you probably better first program that one, and then you calculate the parameter. You first program the covariance and then the parameter. So for a linear model, you just need to calculate these optimized parameters. You just need your grade to do a few mathematics. You just need to calculate partial derivatives. If you have a nonlinear model, we again go to first-order Taylor development, and the only difference is that you need to do an iteration before you come to your optimized parameters, since you need to know your parameters beforehand. You need a first guess. So here, again, if you have a nonlinear model, then you just calculate a few partial derivatives, and you can solve the problem. Now I come to an example here. So here I created an example of experimental points that are totally artificial. Okay, I used them to be clear in what I want to say. So they have an uncertainty, and I fit with a straight line. Okay, so I just use these two equations from the least squares adjustment. I get my parameters with the corresponding covariance, and I suppose that all the input quantities are fully uncorrelated in the beginning. And this I get as a result. So I get back A0, 1, A1, 4, with this covariance matrix, and the correlation coefficient here is minus 0.94. So strongly correlated. Now, I can calculate back, using this covariance matrix, I can calculate the if I would calculate at a certain point here, using these input quantities, my model value, the red line, I can also calculate the corresponding uncertainty to the model value, and then just using here the sandwich formula. And using the full covariance matrix here, it's this dotted line that is the uncertainty on the model values which come from my fit. If I would only use the diagonal terms and forget about the correlation between A0 and A1, I overestimate completely the uncertainties here, and especially in this region. Now, I make another experiment here, which are practically based on the same parameters. And now I fit here the straight line, and I get here again my parameters out together with my correlation coefficient. And my correlation coefficient here is completely different, because my experiment is completely different. The relation between the parameters is the same, the model is the same, but the correlation coefficient is different. It is just, it reflects also the uncertainties of my input quantities, and not only the model. The model is there, but also the uncertainties of the input quantities. Then I do the same game here now with the full uncertainty on the model line. And by supposing only the diagonal elements, of course, now I practically get the same uncertainty because here this correlation coefficient is zero. Okay, so this shows that you really need also the correlation coefficient, even when you have a model, is determined strongly by your input quantities and the covariance of your input quantities. Now here, I made the slope is completely different. The uncertainty structure is practically the same here, and you see that you get practically the same correlation coefficient. So although the slope is different, the correlation coefficient has nothing to do with the slope here. So now, perhaps I can stop here for 5 minutes. And I will take a glass of water. And then if you have in the meantime some questions, Ralph, since now I can... No? Since what I want to do now is I want to go to... I can do this one. I will first do this one. So these are equations which are always thought these are very simple least squares adjustments. Now, these equations are the most general least squares adjustments that you can imagine. And that is not due to anybody else than Fritz Schroeder. So with these equations, Jan, I have the same problem. I didn't see it, yeah. With these equations, I can include uncertainties also on the x-values, and I can also include the prior on the parameters. I just have to use them very intelligently. And they are much stronger than the Bayesian equations that people are used to. So basically, if you have, what you can do is, if you have also a covariance on your x-values, so you have an experiment which is yx, so you measure counts as function of time, so the counts are y and x is time. If you also have an uncertainty on your time, what you do is you include your time also as an experimental input. In addition, you include your time also as a model parameter. And then it's very straightforward, and you just have to change your model. You include in your model the identity x equals x. And that's all what you have to do. And you include, you extend your experimental input, you extend them with your experimental data. And then, you of course, your covariance matrix also contains the covariance on your x. And then you can exactly use the same equations here. So I did this for you using, so you have here the linear equation. So I include now also x as an experimental input quantity. Again, for case of simplicity, I put the non-diagonal terms at zero. So I extend the covariance matrix with my x. I can even, if I want, make a correlation between x2 and y1, if needed. This I can do, if that exists. Then I extend my model. I have not only the A0 and A1 as model parameters, but also my X's are model parameters. And I just have a slightly more complicated sensitivity matrix. So I have a partial derivative of X1 versus X1, of X1 versus, of this is, of X2 versus X1. And then this is X3 versus X1. This is Y1 versus X1, okay, and so on. So it is straightforward to make this these partial derivatives and create your gradient matrix. And then you add also the uncertainties on your X values. You just have to solve this then also by iteration. Since now you need guess parameters for the A1s here. Therefore, you need an iteration here. Now, I can do exactly the same if I have a prior on my parameters. I can do it. I can play exactly the same game. I can add the prior as an experimental input. I extend the experimental input here, and I include the parameters together with their covariance as an experimental input, and I can solve the same equations. And so like this, you can include the uncertainties on the Y, on the X, and you can include the prior. And this even allows you to make cross-correlations if needed. And that you can, so that is explained here. And that you cannot do if, if you do Bayesian theory. Since Bayesian theory is based on the fact that your prior is fully uncorrelated, it cannot have any correlation with your new input. You cannot apply these equations if your prior is correlated with your new input. So in principle, to propagate uncertainties, you can base yourself on two very simple concepts. So that is a conventional general law of uncertainty propagation here, the sandwich formula. You just have to understand your experiment. That means the input quantities, your model. So the input quantities determine this covariance matrix, and your model determines this sensitivity matrix. And then if you do least squares fitting, you have to solve these two equations. You have to understand your model to get the gradient matrix, and you have to understand the input quantities to get your experimental input data. And that's all what you need to do proper uncertainty propagation. Okay, now I will take some water. So now, I will show you some problems. So first of all, I have here again these black resonances. So I have my black resonances here, and I want to determine my background. So this also is part of the background, and I fit this function through it. If I use this data here, like it is represented here, and I fit it and I use my functions, which I showed you, I get this red line as the best fit. Now, this is, of course, complete nonsense. And this is due to the fact that my covariance or my uncertainties or my experimental data points are wrongly estimated. So you need to do a proper evaluation of your uncertainties, because I cannot suppose that these points follow are normal distributed. So I cannot take the square root of the counts as the uncertainty. And that creates this function here. So if I group the data, and I create a much better statistics in my data points, then I get this fit through the data. So what it means is that you need to be careful with your uncertainties if you do a weighted least squares adjustment. And just to compare, this is the fit if you don't do it correctly. It's the same line as this one. Now, this example is also a textbook example, and that is what is called Peirce-Parton puzzle. So what it is it shows, again, how careful you have to be with covariance matrices. So we have two data inputs, y1, y2, with uncorrelated uncertainties, and you multiply them with the factor. And so y1 is 1 plus minus 0.1, y2 is 1.5 plus minus 0.15, and k has a 20% uncertainty. And then we are going to combine this information to get the best value of z, where the model is z equals k multiplied by 1. So I will go through this with you. So I can solve this in two ways, like I did it with the background. I can first calculate the average of y and then multiply this average with k to get my best estimate of z. That is what I would do if I'm the experimentalist, since I have all my full information about the experiment. But if people report only z1 and z2, and this is the experimentalist report z1 and z2, he will give the covariance matrix, and then somebody else will calculate z just having this information available. So now let me first do scheme A. So scheme A, what I do is y1, y2, I go to the best estimate of y using a least square adjustment, nothing else than a weighted average. That's the least squares adjustment if you calculate the mean of these two, the weighted average of these two. So I get this as y, 1.154 plus minus 0.083, and it's represented here by this in the figure. So this is the mean value and this is its uncertainty. Then I multiply by 1 with k, and I account also for the uncertainty on k, and I get this as the best estimate of z. So and this we all understand. Now, we go to the second scheme, so where I create first z1 and z2 out of the covariance matrix. So here is the covariance matrix of y1, y2, and k. So they were not correlated, so this is the covariance matrix of y1, y2, and k. So, and from this, I can produce z1 and z2. I showed you the equations how to do that before. So, and I get the covariance matrix of z. And this is z1, z2 represented here, but the uncertainties are only the square root of the diagonal terms. So then, from these two now, I'm going to calculate my best estimate of z. And what do I get if I apply least squares adjustment? I get 0.882, which is far below the two values. And people were puzzled with it a long time, but so you see here I compare the two values, 1.154 and 0.882. So this is just not acceptable. Now, what is the reason for that is that your covariance matrix is not well built up, the covariance matrix of z1 and z2. And if you do the mathematics of the weighted average of z from the z1 and z2, you see here that if you decompose all the components, that you end up here with something like y1 minus y2, which always pulls it down. Peel will always pull down your result, always, all the time. And I can show hundreds of examples, and we had even I don't have it on the transparency here, it's perhaps a pity. So we have structured cross sections, and if you do a fit, a Hauser-Feshbach fit through the structured cross sections, you always are even, you can be 10% down. And our theoretician, he was really puzzled with it until he came to us and then we said, look, but you have Peel's burden and puzzle. And it's, you always pull down the result due to this artifact here. It's not an artifact if your covariance matrix is well defined. Now, you can read more on the mathematics behind in these two papers. Now, the solution to avoid Peel's Partner and Puzzle is very straightforward. And I gave already also a hint before. We just include, we create a new model. We include the normalization constant k into our model. So when we fit y1, and y1 is z over k, y2 is z over k, and k equals k, and we fit versus z and k. These are the model parameters. And then we fully avoid Peel's Partner and Puzzle. This you can always apply, and you always avoid it. So Peel's Partner and Puzzle will always be there if you have a normalization factor. And if you are y1 and y2, when they are very far from each other and out of uncertainty values. So now if I do this, and if I apply the model y1 equals z over k, y2 equals z over k, k equals k, and I again just use a very simple least squares adjustment, I get my best value here, this value which completely corresponds with, if I would do first the average of y1 and y2 and then apply the normalization factor. It's exactly the same solution. So now a few words about definitions and terminology. Since it's also very important when you report uncertainties that you report them with the correct terminology. First of all, there is a difference between an error and an uncertainty. Now, precision and accuracy we have heard from Nicola already, and then there is a way how to report uncertainties. Now, a measurement error is an error is the difference between two values. It can be negative or positive. Now, an uncertainty is related to the width of a distribution, so an uncertainty is always positive. So by definition, they are different. So, and it's explained here. So the measurement, the error, is the difference between the result and a reference value. Most, if it's the true, if you put here the true value, we can never determine the error since we never know the true value, unfortunately. But so that is an error. And an uncertainty is related to the width of this distribution. So there is a clear distinction between the two. So don't write error when you mean uncertainty. So then, if you, to avoid errors, of course, you need to try to include all systematic effects which are related to your measurement. And in my simple example here, I show the background. So in case I would not correct for my background, I would systematically make an error, but it is not my uncertainty of the measurement. But I make systematically an error by not correcting for the background. And once I correct for the background, I go, of course, closer to my true value. I will never know how close, but we hope that by properly evaluating the uncertainties which are related to the input quantities, that the width of this green distribution here covers also that my result is also close to the true value. But this we will never know. Since otherwise, if we know the true value, we don't have to measure. So so we will never know also the error that we make, never, since we don't know the true value. But we can just try to do our best to estimate as good as possible the uncertainties which are related to all the input quantities of the measurement process. Same is true for if we apply a correction factor. So the background is a correction, a normalization is a correction factor. So we can apply this factor, we can come closer to the true value. If I would not apply this factor, I would systematically make an error. But it has nothing to do with the systematic uncertainty, since it's completely different. Now here, I can try to increase, I can try to lower this width of the blue distribution here by increasing the number of points or by increasing the number of measurements. In some cases, but I will never be able to decrease then the width which is due to this systematic component of my uncertainty. So this is in relative terms here the uncertainty on the z-value now. So then measurement precision and accuracy, that has been nicely explained by Nicola already, but if you are inaccurate, it mostly means that you did not include all the systematic corrections that you had to apply. So another thing is, if we report based on the standard deviation of the normal distribution, then we call it a standard uncertainty. And sometimes people will also, and that means that we have a coverage of about 68% of the distribution. So a coverage interval of about 68%. Some people report by multiplying with a factor about 2, and then they go to a coverage interval of 0.95. If you do this, then you have to report it as an expanded uncertainty, and you also have to report the factor that you applied. So the most easy thing is mostly just call it a standard, do a one sigma uncertainty and call it a standard uncertainty. And then everybody knows what you're reporting. If you multiply with a factor, you have to specify your factor. Then if you also sometimes will see the term combined uncertainties. This does nothing, means nothing else than that they have propagated all the uncertainties which are related to the measurement process. That is what they call combined uncertainties. So, but that is nothing else than just trying to include all uncertainties of your measurement process. So, and this brings me already to the end. So, to produce reliable experimental data and results, we just have to understand the measurement process. That means the experimental observables which are involved and the model. And once you understand this, you can easily define the covariance matrix. You just have to apply these two formulas. So the sandwich formula, if you do just normal uncertainty propagation, then it's a convention of a function of quantities. And here, if you do least squares adjustment. How to do this for time of flight measurements, we have created what is called the AGS formalism. And this Jan will explain tomorrow. And we will also have some exercises on this AGS formalism. But the formalism is nothing else than the sandwich that based on these two equations here, and with an additional component that we use one nice thing of the covariance matrix, that is positive definite, that we can always apply a Kolesky transformation, and then we can make this equation even more easy to use. And it will allow you to report nicely all the uncertainties which are involved in the final result that you will show. So, and now I come to the end. So if you are interested, we will have a dedicated workshop on the generation of use of covariance data in nuclear applications. It's a combined workshop, combined organization of SEK-CEN, our national institute in Belgium, and our institute, and it will be from 10 to 11 December at our institute. So, and that is all what I wanted to say.
What you have presented in a very user-friendly way. The second remark I would like to make is that the new version of the GAN, there is now a new draft of the GAN, new version of the GAN, concentrates now more on avoiding these linearization things and go really to propagation of the using Monte Carlo techniques.
Yeah, that's true, that's true. So I have a presentation on that, but that in principle, what it does, and then you need Bayesian. It's my second slide, I think, which I showed. What you do is you propagate probability distributions, and you do not do the conventional uncertainty propagation. So with conventional uncertainty propagation, we start from a normal distribution and use the properties of the width of the normal distribution. And that is all what we do. We use the properties of the width of the normal distribution, and with this we can propagate the uncertainties. Now, in the new, due to improved computing power, of course, what you can now easily do is propagate probability distributions. But then again, you have to suppose something about your probability distribution.
You have to know whether the uncertainty you have for your measurement is normal or not.
Yeah.
It can be not normal.
Yeah. But if you, yeah, yeah.
was.
No, 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 here it comes. Yeah, that is an application of it. No, no, it's, this is an application. So this is just... So here I propagate the distributions. Here I propagate the distributions. No, no, due to the computing powers, now you can do Monte Carlo calculations.
Actually, the software which I use, Scum Workbench, also has an expert, as it's called, for doing exactly that.
Now, if you do then, if you go to least square fitting, it's a bit more tricky.
Yeah.
But I have examples that you can also, that what we show already is we can determine resonance parameters, avoiding the least square fitting and just use it, but we have to use Bayesian theory then. And then we use probability distributions, and we start, of course, from a normal distribution, but you can easily determine resonance parameters based on Bayesian, on propagation of probability distributions. But this is, this all what I said is based on propagating the width of a distribution. That's all what it is. It's correct, Ralph.
A demonstration version which I got from the manufacturer for the purpose of this code. And obviously, of course, since he wants to earn money, he has switched off certain things. Among these things was the possibility to change the kind of distribution. And this is why it was not working, it was on purpose. And I have put another version which you need to install. There it works, but there are other things do not work. So it's also a demonstration version. This is what I can do for you if you want me to want to use this web to pay. I'm sorry.
It comes from which software?
This Scum Workbench.
Okay.
So you find now one version in my codes folder which is ready to run. You don't have to install it. This was the one we had on Monday. And there is another one which you can install and which has different deficiencies. Also a demonstration version which you actually also can download from the web page of this company who is training that stuff. So you can try this out and if you like it you can buy it.
And the previous picture which you showed with the summation of the three independent previous one where there was a different distribution.
Ah, I have to go a bit further. Ah, no, I'm already here, yeah.
Yeah, so, and this is a you propagated by Monte Carlo?
No, that you can do analytically. That you just, that is in...
You can do this exercise.
Yeah, we could do the exercise, yeah. This you can do analytically. I don't need Monte Carlo. Now, nowadays people would probably do it Monte Carlo, then they don't have to think anymore. Yeah. But in principle it shows that conventional uncertainty propagation is not so bad.
No.
Yeah.
I mean, there are certain pathological cases where you really have some difficulties, but for 90% of our work,
and I wanted, so at least when I started with it, they made me afraid about all these covariances and correlations. And what I tried to do was to say, look, there is no secret behind. If you know what you are doing, you can easily build up your covariance matrix. It's just... The thing is, as soon as you can go back to the origin of your experiment, if you have that and you understand your experiment, the covariance matrix is there for free.
Yeah, so maybe the people afraid about this mathematics, this covariance, to make it transparent, reversible, and so on. From this point of view, Victor Zetkin practical exercises with Explore, where I believe he will show his web tools, yeah, where you as experimentalist input your parameters, say it is uncorrelated, it is correlated, correlation is such value, and then you generate click, and then you generate...
That is something that I don't hear, we know that they are correlated. So like Z1 and Z2, if you do the background subtraction, they are correlated. But I cannot tell you in advance what is the correlation coefficient.
Yeah.
That depends from the experiment.
Yeah, sure.
And that is sometimes people think that the correlation coefficient is a fixed value. And that is not true. And a lot of people believe that the correlation coefficient is really almost like a nuclear data. And that is completely wrong, since it just reflects the full uncertainty, it includes the model through the sensitivity matrix, but it also includes the covariance of your original data. Yeah, but there are not some people, and even I don't tell names here, but who think that correlation coefficients, I can resonance parameters, for example, which are nuclear data. So they ask me, is gamma n correlated with gamma gamma? So I can build an experiment that the correlation is zero. I can build an experiment that the correlation is one, and I can build an experiment that the correlation is minus one. You just have to ask me. I can design the experiment.
So all these correlations, they really reflect not physics, since there is no correlation practically in the objective nature, in the physics. They reflect how this data was received. It is experiment, then it reflects how you measure. If you, for example, measure something as a function of energy, but you use only one normalization factor, then it brings that all your data are correlated. If you use normalization independently, calibration at every incident energy, then all points will be independent. So it's a reflect your methodology, how you obtain the data. It's only you who knows this. Nobody after you will know such a detail. So this is why please submit your data in the X4 once again with uncertainty and the correlations.
Okay. Yeah?
It's a non-experiment list. Could you give me a short example where you explain, you said this is easy to figure out the experimental covariance matrix. For diagonal, it's clear. For the off-diagonal, could you give me a simple example?
Yeah, I gave two simple examples. I subtracted the background and I multiply with the constant. And these are practically the most common operations that we apply. We subtract the background and we multiply with the coefficient.
Yeah, but you see that it's not simple. People didn't understand that it's simple.
So, what you are asking is the model, but
yeah. Here it is. I go through again with you. Yeah, okay. No. I will. Yeah. No. This is. I thought then I was much too fast. Since this is the most important. So basically, this is my experiment. I measure y1 with an uncertainty and y2 with an uncertainty. And they are not correlated, since we know that they are not correlated. And then. We have a background on these two. This background I measured 2 days before, and now I measure Y1, and now I measure Y2, 2 other days. So now I do a background subtraction. I calculate Y1 minus B and Y2 minus B. Now, I know, and this is the clue. If you can start here, then it's straightforward. Since if I know my experiment and I know that these are not correlated, then I can fill up this covariance matrix. And then they are all zero here.
Because you know...
I know my experiment.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Now, if there would be some correlation, because the experiment was the same, you know, set up, and you have done it 1 hour later, or something like that, so you say there is some correlation.
That I don't know. I'm not able to do it. I can only go back to this.
I think what Mr. Leiche...
Yeah? Yeah.
Because it can happen that your matrix gets non-positive definite. And why this is a problem in the year, I guess, on Friday.
What is to find out elements which might be not positive?
Yeah, but then you have to be, yeah, but mostly we as experimentalists, if we are not able to do this, then we don't understand our experiment.
Right. This is exactly the point.
If we are not able to do that, then it's somebody who doesn't understand the experiment. And that is the point. Yeah.
I just can give an example. During this last key comparison on plus desk, and I just checked whether the matrix is positive definite, and it was not. And then
this was only because
it simply guessed something without really knowing the thing. So the off-diagonal terms really have to come from knowledge.
My question was exactly, is there some example, basic example, where you can say, I can fill in for a specific experiment some of the off-diagonal terms? Or is it something, basically you go only to a diagonal matrix?
For example, if you
So what I can do is with you, so this is for the background, yes? So this is the background, so that's easy to fill that one in. So, So this is when I multiply, this is another model, when I multiply with a constant. But again, this term here, so if you calculate the correlation coefficient of this term, you divide by the square root of this one, multiply with the square root of that one. Now, it all depends on the magnitude of your uncorrelated component with respect to UK. So I can make this one, this correlation coefficient, zero, or I can make it one, depending on the uncorrelated components here. So what you ask me is very difficult to answer. And if, like Ralph said, if somebody gives you straightforward the answer, it means that he doesn't understand the experiment. Since we have to think, I would not be able to do it.
What we provide is not this original quantities, it's not already elaborated ones. And in that moment, we have to provide the covariance values, because if not, other people will guess them.
Yeah, but I provide them here. But I can only provide them if I start from from a zero to none. And then, at the end of the day, I give you this matrix. But I cannot give if you say, look, this guy did an experiment, what was his correlation coefficient? I will not be able to give you the answer.
Yeah, but here in this case, you need to explain why it is here something but not zero. And this is exactly.
So this here comes from the k value. So that is the correlated component due to the multiplication of k. So,
because this parameter is affected by the distribution.
Yes.
This is a model. This is. Pardon?
For a raw experiment, you measure something.
Yeah, that is the why. Pardon? Yeah.
Parameters which affect your result, the raw result. Is there an off-diagonal element which you create simply from this information?
For example, if...
just an example,
please. Yeah, and if...
I have no idea.
Situation that you measure two times with one detector, and you measure a slightly different distance, but you use the same gauge to measure this distance. Then, due to the uncertainty of this gauge, you have a correlation in these two distance measurements.
Yeah, and that is this
the
k factor here.
This then would be two k values, so to say, from two measurements, but they are correlated.
Yeah, but the, yeah,
the
yeah.
Then
you have
yeah, yeah, yeah. But you have to go and try to estimate them, and you can only try to estimate them starting from zero values. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
the gauge is the model, And practically it comes here. That is your model.
Yeah.
And then if you have, you can have two values, K1 and K2, and K1 and K2 might have a common uncertainty component, but then you have to do your best and try to provide this uncertainty component. So a big job for us, and we did not stress it in the presentation of Friday, but a big job for us is to estimate uncertainties. And we sometimes spend as much time, we did already a lot of measurements to estimate uncertainties. I can give you the example of this black resonance fitting here. So we will give you on Friday values of the uncertainties that we have. And then on Friday we will show you how we in principle introduce in the uncertainty propagation what we can call a model uncertainty. But it's based on measurements. So basically, you even asked the question how many fixed filters you put in. So normally, if we would measure here, we don't put fixed filters here, but we put them in here. Now then we know how to correct using these filters. Now to go to estimate the uncertainty in this region here, what we do then is we do additional measurements with each time filters in. We apply the procedure when we have the sample in, exactly the same procedure, and then we check how close we are to the background. Then we do a statistical analysis of all this data, and from that statistical analysis, we determine an uncertainty component. And that is then an uncertainty component which tells us how good we are in estimating the background. And then what we do is, in principle, it's very easy. If you saw the formula C in minus B in transmission, what we do is we multiply this equation here with a K factor, and the K factor comes from our evaluation of the uncertainties, and it is related to the model.
The K factor is 1?
It is 1. So first of all, we check that the difference between the measured values here and the fitted value, that the average is 1, otherwise we have a bias. And then we make an error. But that is not the uncertainty, it's the variance of the ratios which determines our uncertainty. But we do dedicated measurements to do the uncertainty evaluation, which is sometimes more time consuming than to do the measurement itself. And a lot of people then, unfortunately I have to say, they take our uncertainty values and they quote them, and it's not so fair. You have to evaluate yourself your uncertainties, and they are related to the experimental setup you have.
I only want to add that probably tomorrow with exercise that we have to come back to this because we will introduce the K and the code.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.